What are you doing?
I'm doing a documentary on jazz rock.
Really? That's a good one. That would be good. That hasn't really been covered, has it?
Not at all.
No.
I mean, it's been left out of the jazz canon.
Yeah.
You know, it's a story that needs to be told.
Yeah.
And I'm trying to get the story makers to tell it. I've compiled a bunch of interviews.
That's good.
And I'm not just talking to people that made the music, I'm talking to people that were affected by the music also.
Yeah. Well, you should ask me.
You don't know. Well, yeah.
I was heavily affected.
Right. I mean, you really don't know the true effect that the music really has unless you talk to the people that
of course
were affected by it.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. Of course. I mean, that's a really good idea because, I mean, jazz rock is not really, noted, is it? It's not.
No, I mean, you know, what happened is like it came on the scene and then it morphed to this thing called fusion.
Yeah.
And basically when we were doing that music, it was not fusion, it was jazz rock. It had the power of rock and roll,
yeah.
The volume.
Of course.
But harmonically speaking and rhythmically speaking, it had the sophistication of jazz.
And the improvisation as well.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's part of it.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, like progressive rock, they have started to improvise.
Yeah.
But not on the same scale as what the jazz rock guys.
But I mean, don't you think that maybe it was kept out because of things like, you know, Jimi Hendrix, that great black rock musician?
You know what? Here's a little trivia here. I was playing in a club. I had already done the record with Miles, and he came to this club that I was playing at one night. And I was in awe of Miles Davis.
Yeah.
I mean, like, Miles Davis is my hero.
Yeah, sure.
So my whole being was to play with Miles Davis. Now, I had gotten an opportunity to record with him, so I wanted him to just say, come on and be in my band, you know. So he comes to me and he says, do you want to play with Jimi Hendrix? And I said, nah. So I regret that to this day, you know, because I really wanted to play with him. But, like, he was going to set up a situation where, like, I was going to be able to play with Jimi Hendrix.
Wow. Yeah. That would have been incredible.
I would have liked to try that.
That would have changed your...
I think so.
Yeah.
But, you know, the thing about it is that I'm doing my first CD in 10 years. It'll come out next year. And I went back and
rocked.
Did jazz rock.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Who did you bring on the album?
Well, Stanley's playing on one cut.
Yeah.
But I have a band that I put together that I was traveling with. There's a guitarist by the name of Tom Guana.
Mm-hmm.
And George Colligan played keyboards.
Mm-hmm.
Along with another keyboard artist by the name of I forgot his name now. Vince Evans.
Okay.
And my dear friend from a long time ago, Bernard Wright.
Yeah.
Donald Blackman, who was in my Astro Pirates band. Nick Morrock played guitar in my Astro Pirates band.
Mm-hmm.
I brought a lot of guys back from the Astro Pirates days.
Mm-hmm.
Great young bass player, Richie Goods, is playing. And then, like, a friend of mine who used to play in my band, who now is like a mega pop rock producer, by the name of David Bendeth. And he did Paramore and All Time Low. He did Breaking Benjamin.
Mm-hmm.
He's got a bunch of hits. And so we got back together and played some Rockin' Out. We can spend another decade, another century blaming somebody else.
Mm.
I think you have to just take some responsibility. And you don't have to reinvent the wheel.
No.
find your place on the wheel,
yeah.
and educate yourself and your loved ones about
this
kind of situation.
How this wheel is working.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And once you do that, you know, like you at least have the mindset where, like, okay, I know that that's everybody's going down that path. I know that that's wrong.
Yeah.
So I have to find an alternative.
Mm.
And you tell your sons and daughters that, and like they act accordingly.
Yeah.
You know, great American comedian who's no longer here, but a very self-conscious comedian,
George Carlin. Yeah, of course.
George Carlin said something.
Read your mind.
No, but he said something that was so profound.
Mm.
It's one of the most profound things that I've heard anybody say in the past 10 years. He said, in order for you to partake in the American dream, you have to be asleep.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's what a lot of people are.
Yeah.
They're
having a nap.
Yeah, but you better wake up. You know.
Yeah.
You know. You know, you create this art. That's great. You know the dynamic. I heard Joni Mitchell say, she said that, you know, she spent better part of maybe 2 years creating a product, writing songs and creating this
piece
statement
mm.
of where she was in present tense. And then she goes to a record company executive and sits down and plays it, and he says, well, I don't like this one, I don't, you know, somebody
yeah.
that
yeah.
you know, that dynamic where like you have such a commitment to your art, and like you spend the better part of
your life,
a couple of years, to create this thing, and then you have a business person say that they don't like it.
Yeah.
What does that do to the artist? How does it make the artist feel?
It's pretty destructive, isn't it?
Yeah, so if you spend that amount of time on creating your art, think about how you want to get it out to people, and maybe, you know, you don't give it to. See, I think one of the things that artists fear, because in the 20th century there was the boom about you make art, you give it to quote unquote big record company, and then they promote it, and like you reap huge benefits from that as an artist. But maybe we should think about maybe not reaping that this amount of benefits, but like taking a little bit more responsibility about what it is that we do, and pinpoint and direct that, and, you know, get the same results, but not on the grandioso scale. Because, I mean, if you can change, you know, 10 people's viewpoint on something,
that's not a bad thing.
That's a good thing. I mean, from a positive standpoint, you know, that's a good thing. So, I mean, you know, I know all of us, you know, thinking about it. I mean, like just John McLaughlin and Chick Stanley, myself. I mean, you know, we're making records and I'm making recordings, or whatever, and it's going to be on our labels, or you know, I look for a distributor. But then again, it's about taking a little bit more control of your life. I mean, you know, people wake up, you know, every morning, man, I don't feel good. Maybe stop eating what you were eating to make you feel that way, and then that's taking a little bit more responsibility. You know, it starts from
very small steps,
you know, and then it becomes a way of life, and then, like, you know, you influence someone else's life, and they say, hey, man, wow, those two guys, what do you guys look so great. What are you doing to, I want to try that.
Mm-hmm.
There's three, and then it goes on.
Yeah.
Right.